It is a common sight in the mornings to see children in colored uniforms being taken in autos, scooters, cycles, buses or cars to various nursery schools in the city.
They seem too young to be going to a formal school. By international standards, they are too young.
These children are between the age group of 2 and 5 years, an age when children enjoy playing and being free to discover things around them, instead of doing things that restrict their creativity.
They are being ushered into the rushing world of our making at such a tender age. The child is not an observer here, but very much part of that rush. Whether he likes it or not, whether he can cope with it or not, he is given no choice but to flow along. Or else, many in society feel he will be left behind.
You have to learn to pace yourself. Pressure. You're just like everybody else. Pressure. You've only had to run so far, so good. But you will come to a place where the only thing you
do you think stress and pressure are only an adult phenomenon?
Are you aware about stress among preschool children?
Do you know that the pressures of present preschool education are causing pain and damage to the physical and mental health of our little ones?
This program invites you to take a closer look at the lives of many preschool children in India, and you may find that behind their smiling faces there are marks of anguish, hurry, overload, and a growing disinterest in education. In short, a childhood which is being programmed carelessly to achieve temporary results.
In this program, we would like to cover the following points: pressures on children and first standard admissions, pressures on children and the opinions of experts in the medical profession, pressures on children and the role played by nursery schools. We will also briefly go through a day in the life of a preschool child and look at the pressure points on the child. And finally, we will offer a few suggestions. Let's begin with the opinion expressed by a concerned parent about preschool educational system prevalent in urban India today.
I think that the present pre-primary education system has become extremely detrimental to a child's all-round growth. Instead of developing a child's all-round growth by cultivating his tremendous interest in play, by nurturing his curiosity in discovering the world around him, instead of including all these things into his academic curriculum, the present-day system is bogged down with forcing him to do things for which he is not really prepared. Things like reading, writing, number works, spellings, these don't help him to grow in a very natural way. I think that these first standard entrance tests should take the major blame for burdening the children in India. And the situation just seems to get worse. The children are somehow carrying on under tremendous pressure, but one can't say for how long.
That was a mother's outburst on the day of her son's admission test. She had received negative replies from 2 other schools. Let's take a look at the first standard admission test phenomenon in most cities in India. Many of you are familiar with the procedure adopted for first standard admissions in many reputed schools. The parents collect admission forms on a particular day or days. They sometimes stand in the queue the whole night before to collect forms. This queue started at 3 a.m. in the morning. and the queue for this school began at 7 in the evening of the previous day. Schools then appoint a day for the written test. Those who pass the test are called for personal interviews. Children who do well are admitted into the first standard. There are three key issues connected with admission into schools for Standard 1. A limited number of good schools in the city, the admission test criteria, a set portion and previous knowledge demanded for the entrance tests and interview. Let's take a look at each of these briefly. There are a limited number of so-called good schools or prestigious schools or schools in demand in each city. They are better known as lead schools. The increase in population, urbanization, and related problems have caused the number of children wanting admissions into lead schools in the last 10 years to double. Unfortunately, there has been no corresponding rise in the number of good schools in the cities, especially English medium schools. Even in regional language schools nowadays, one notices the same pattern of schools getting flooded with admission seekers and parents standing in line for forms and admissions.
कारण काल सकाळपासून आम्ही रांगेत उभे आहोत रात्रभर इथे
मिस्टर सुरेश थेओर an ex-mayor of Pune has been waiting in the queue from 10 a.m. of the previous day to obtain a form for standard 1 in this Marathi medium school sometimes even as high as 10:1 for every child selected there will be 5 or 10 who will be rejected is it necessary to make the child face the pangs of rejection and failure at this early age many schools make merit the basis of selection and this has become a dilemma both for parents and children a child is influenced by his temperaments and moods on the day of his test or interview this will greatly affect his performance In the actual interview, expecting him to do his best in front of a stranger in a strange environment is being unrealistic. The result of this kind of testing is never a reliable assessment of the child.
I would especially like to warn parents and educators about the dangers of testing, especially academic testing for little children, talking about 5-year-old children. It's a very well-known fact in the United States that only about 20% of all the things that you would assess a child having to do with whether they're ready to go to school or how well they're going to do in school is based upon academics. And so for schools here to place 100% of assurances on how a child is going to do in school on academic intelligence is just not right. In the United States, it's even what's called late bloomers, and these are children which really don't come into their own until their late teen years or even in their mid-20s. And everyone knows that you could take a particular IQ test one day with a certain mood, and then you could take it another day and test out very different. So that to place the entire future of some little child on how a child does at age 5 is absolutely preposterous.
So, admission tests at best test the child's rote learning capability and nothing more. Such tests have no scientific validity and they are doing more damage than good. Some of the principals of lead schools that we spoke to were aware of the limitations of such tests. While some said that they were reluctantly sticking to it, others insisted that this was the fairest method of selection.
For selection, we have 3 or 4 criteria, but the main one is the one of merit. That's what we believe in. That's the most just system that we can think of. Anyone who has worked up towards getting admission to our school should be selected for the very fact that he's put in some efforts.
And so, these tests are going to be around for some time.
Is there something wrong in starting these formal educational activities at an early age? What do specialists in the medical profession have to say about this?
Now, it is very important to know that this child develops into two phases. The first phase, that's the first 3 years of life, the child is concentrating on developing the motor skills, which are gross. Like, for example, a child who was lying down starts sitting up, starts standing, starts running around. Or if the child who was not speaking before starts speaking, a child who could not identify an object starts identifying it. And these are all gross motor skills, which has nothing to do with education. Education primarily is a fine motor skill, and fine motor skills usually start developing around 5 years of age. Now, suppose we are loading this brain by fine motor skills, it would ultimately cause enormous reaction from the brain. That would be in the form of problems of behavior, especially in the form of tremendous anxiety. And this anxiety can perpetuate further behavioral problems. Now, is it necessary to teach a 3-year-old child numbers? The answer is, it is futile. It is not necessary. Is it necessary to teach a child alphabets at the age of 3 years? The answer is no, it is not necessary. What one really has to concentrate is to improve his play in the form of gross movements like running or climbing or skipping or hopping or jumping. These are the things that one has to concentrate upon, and not formal education.
A very important development also takes place at 5 years of age. That means a dynamic tripod grip begins. In simple words, it means the adult pattern of holding a pencil, where thumb and index finger is used to hold a pencil and the middle finger is used for support. Before this time, a child is using his shoulder joint for writing in gross movements. That means he's writing with the shoulder movement. Afterwards, the shoulder gets stabilized and the child starts writing with movement of the elbow. At 5 years, only the shoulder and the elbow joint are stabilized and the child starts writing using his finger movements or finger joints. And this is the time which is when he is actually ready for writing. So when the child is introduced writing, before he is really ready for it, what happens is he puts lot of strain on his wrist, writes with too much pressure, sits in very awkward posture, which gives him backache or body ache. Also holds his writing material very close to his eyes, which can give him eye problem. And ultimately the child refuses to write or hates writing.
So, though children are not ready to begin formal educational exercises at 2.5, 3, they are being forced to do so. Many parents are preoccupied with their own jobs and cannot give enough time to train their children. However, they expect them to be ahead of the rest in this highly competitive world. So, to fulfill this so-called urgent need in society, many private nurseries have mushroomed in all the cities of India. Since parents are busy and there's so much that the child needs to know, the nurseries are offering to do the job. A recent survey conducted in Pune asking parents to state reasons for sending their children to nurseries brings to light the following statistics. A similar survey conducted in Delhi has the following figures.
Nursery schools may look the same from the outside, but depending upon the purpose of training children and the methodology adopted to achieve this purpose, we may distinguish them in the following ways. Some nursery schools are either ignorant about the unhealthy pressure that the demands of learning have on the children, or they care little about it. These nursery schools began purely as a source of income. Quality education is not usually their top priority. There are others who are aware that these demands of learning are taxing children, but wish to continue to do so because they claim they are trying to meet a need of society, or what is known as the playway method. It has also been proved that children of 4 to 4.5 pick up in 2 weeks that which the 3 to 3.5 year olds take 2 months to learn. So pressurizing children at an early age is futile when they can learn the same things faster a little later. There are also a few unique nurseries which do not train children for any admission tests of any school.
We do not cater to any entrance tests for the first standard for any particular school, as we firmly believe that this pressurizes the child and he has to do much more than what he can actually cope up with. We follow the playway methods, which gives more meaningful and joyful experiences to the young child. I know and I'm aware that this causes a lot of disappointment and discouragement as far as the parents are concerned. But we will continue with this methodology because it is in the interest of the young child whom we care and love so much.
Then there are some private nurseries which unfortunately are much in demand among parents because they almost seem to say, we guarantee admission into good schools. These exert a lot of pressure on children because they are narrowly geared to preparing children for the first standard admission test and nothing more. Some parents call them concentration camps. So, feeder nurseries are in high demand today, and many of them now have elaborate admission procedures of their own. They demand registration of the child when the child is only a few months old.
Well, I have a son and a small daughter who is just about 10 months old. Now, when I went to check on my son's admission, I also made it a point to check on what's the likelihood of admission for my daughter. And to my surprise, the principal there asked me, how old is your daughter? I said, she's 10 months. He said, you're already late, because we've got bookings for children who are just 1 month old for 4 years hence, that is for the year 1995. So I had no choice, but I just requested her, and with great difficulty and great reluctance, she has accepted the name she has kept on her file, the name and address of my daughter, who will be seeking admission to the junior KG in the year 1995.
We also know of many nurseries in Bombay where parents have to register their child's, or rather their infant baby's, names immediately after birth. This, however, doesn't guarantee admissions into those nurseries. When these infants are around 2 to 2.5 years of age, they are called for admission interviews. These tests range from interviewing the parents to interviewing the child itself at 2 to 2.5 years of age. Questions range from, what is your name? How many fingers do you have? To what color is this? Name 3 vegetables. Needless to say, many coaching classes have sprung up offering to coach 1.5 to 2 year olds on how to face their first interview in life. So, preschool education in India is becoming more and more a downward extension of primary or formal education. One wonders where we are heading.
Many parents believe that if they force their children to achieve things early in life, they will be successful. Children can take an overload to some extent, but they cannot express the hurt of the pressure on them. The stress, the academic overload, manifests itself in behavioral problems.
Here are 2 children who have come to us with the problem of stammering. As a child psychologist, we come across many behavioral problems in children. The common behavioral problems are stammering, aggressive behavior, temper tantrums, bedwetting, nail biting, thumb sucking, and in some cases even inferiority complex, school refusal and withdrawal. Now, in our analysis of these problems, what we have found out is that the causes of these problems can be traced to the different stresses related to the early education these children face.
If you force open a rosebud, it fails to bloom in all its natural beauty. And it is a simple rule that when things are pushed beyond their limits, the whole system just breaks down. From the field of sports too, we can draw a few parallel lessons.
And Clark Gable coming up with a sustained run on the wider outside. It's Kokomo now, and here comes Clark Gable on the outside.
Nowadays, in the field of horse training in the Western countries, the trend is to train the horses at a much younger age. The horses are taken on for training when they have not yet matured. Too much is being asked of them. As a result, what happens is they tend to break down while being trained, and not only that, they also break down while in racing, which is not desired had they been prepared slowly and given more time. They would peak at a later date and perform better. Not only perform better, they would last longer also.
Medical experts in the field of sports in the United States are warning coaches that youngsters should not be overstrained for long periods at a young age, or else they will face an early burnout.
Another good friend is an educational psychologist in California, and he works with children who are 7, 8, 9, 10 years of age, either committing suicide or attempting suicide because of the pressures that they face in school. They're called burned out. These are children that already have are casualties to this fast-paced pressure that are put upon children at a very young age to succeed in life.
So, an important factor is that education and child development should go hand in hand. If the pace of education overtakes the child's developmental capabilities, then it puts pressure on the child and becomes counterproductive. Before we close with a few suggestions, let's take a quick look at a day in the life of a normal preschool child. You may be shocked to know that his normal day is filled with pressure points from dawn to dusk. A preschool child needs to be pulled out of bed for school. A little time on the potty, but that's not enough for the child. The child is not in the mood, nor has she an appetite so early in the morning to eat adequately. So, many times it's just a glass of milk. The mother dresses the child hurriedly, and with a heavy bag, he gets into a crowded rickshaw. It has been estimated that on an average, the time taken between waking up the child and putting him in the auto is 33 minutes. The child at that age needs 2 to 3 times that much time. The rickshaw takes anywhere between half an hour to an hour to reach the school, since other children need to be picked up along the way. Some nurseries close their gates after their opening bell, so you can imagine the rush and the danger of fast driving to bring the children in time. The child reaches the school and perhaps gets into a crowded classroom. 30, 40 or 60 children in one class. Sometimes the ventilation in the classroom is poor and many suffer from repeated infections like cold, fever and diarrhea. And often, the teacher he faces is not properly trained in early childhood education and child development. And if the numbers are too large, she may not be able to give much personal attention. Often, the methodology adopted, as we have already seen, does not take into account the child's developmental capabilities. After nursery hours, some children are required to go for extra tuitions. Then in the evening, there's homework to do, which is mostly repeatedly writing the alphabets, numbers and spellings. And many times, this is how the day ends for the child. We are just trying to show through all this the pressure points in the life of a preschool child. In the light of the issues discussed so far, are there any remedial measures that the government, schools, teachers and parents can take to alter this appalling situation? We offer a few suggestions. The government should encourage opening of more schools and render all the support needed to the schools to establish themselves as institutions able to give quality education. Admission tests are a social menace, a traumatic experience both for parents and children. Schools and nurseries need to adopt alternate admission systems like lottery system, first come, first serve, preference for neighborhood children, some kind of representative quota system. For example, in Delhi, 192 model composite schools coming under Delhi administration have abolished admission tests from June 1992 and have adopted randomized lottery system to take students in. Teachers need to put in lots more creative effort in blending academics with play. The playway method of learning is a better way and must be adopted. There should be regular meetings between parents and teachers for mutual exchange of ideas and issues pertaining to the child's education. Schools and social organizations should spearhead the cooperation of medical professionals and educators to enable teachers learn about education-related health problems that children face.
Often, the only interaction between the father and his child is, "Have you done your homework?" Fathers, and sometimes both parents, don't make time for their children. Children are taken for granted, except in a crisis. There is absolutely no substitute for parents spending time with their children in play, in their studies, and in their discovery of the world around them. Loretta De Silva is involved in the training of nursery teachers and students of child development at undergraduate levels. She, along with many other educators, agree that their students should equip themselves to think creatively so that the pressures on children under the present educational system are reduced. Alvin Toffler said, "From now on, the world will be split between the fast and the slow. And there is a great compulsion on everyone, young and old, to conform to the fast-paced life, or be left behind." Preschool children are trying to adjust to this fast-paced world of ours. Your help can make a difference. Preschool education need not be a drudgery. If you can make an effort in reducing the pressure at the various pressure points that we have focused on in this program, preschool education for millions of our children in India can become a joyful experience.